Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 10th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff present that the Parliament's social distancing rules apply, and if you are walking around the room or entering or leaving the room, if you could wear face coverings, please. You don't have to wear face coverings while you're seated and giving evidence. The first item on the agenda is for the committee to agree or not to take items 3 and 4 in private. Is that agreed? Yes, that's agreed. Thank you. The next item is our consideration of a Section 22 report, which was published earlier this year by the Auditor General into Scottish Canals. And can I welcome our witnesses to the committee this morning? I'm pleased to welcome Catherine Topley, who's the Chief Executive of Scottish Canals, Andrew Thin, who's the Chair of the Board of Scottish Canals, Sarah Jane Hanna, who's the Director of Finance and Business Services at Scottish Canals. We've also got a team in from Transport Scotland, led by Hugh Gillis, who's the Interim Chief Executive of Transport Scotland. Welcome. We're also joined by Fran Pacitti, who is the Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight, but I think for the purpose of this morning, and Canals in your job title. So welcome, Fran. And we've also got with us this morning Lee Shedden, who's the Financial Controller at Transport Scotland. I want to begin, Catherine Topley, by inviting you to make a short opening statement to the committee, and then we'll have a series of questions from members of the committee. So over to you, Catherine.
Thank you very much, Convener. In July 2012, Scottish Canals became a standalone public body in Scotland, marking the end of a 50-year cross-border public corporation. In accordance with the Transport Act 1968, waterways, reservoirs and towpaths were written off in a capital reconstruction and have never been disclosed in Scottish Canals' annual accounts nor valued for audit purposes since this date. No asset valuation was conducted at the time of the transition, and the framework of statutory reporting saw the canal infrastructure being left off Scottish Canals' books. No external audit concerns were raised on the transition figures by Grant Thornton at the time, and our 2012-13 accounts were approved by Audit Scotland. The assets, liabilities and operations in Scotland began reporting to the Scottish Government under the management of Scottish Canals, the operating name of the British Waterways Board, which was sponsored through Transport Scotland. In October 2012, Audit Scotland presented an audit plan at Scottish Canals' board meeting, identifying NDPB reclassification as a key risk in the future and stating that the value of the canals would have to be considered if that reclassification occurred. However, it was decided that Scottish Canals would remain a public corporation at that time, at least until 2015-16 for accounting purposes, with an ONS review to be conducted. In 2017, Scottish Canals performed a high-level valuation of the canal infrastructure in line with ONS review, and in May 2018 published our 2018-30 Asset Management Strategy, setting out a risk-based approach to managing the complex range of our 4,100 assets in our care. We also published an overall canal replacement value of an estimated £1.78 billion. We are not asked to include the replacement value in our books and records, and this assessment was not a technical accounting valuation. In September 2019, we were advised by ONS that they had analysed our accounts on our website and concluded that we did not meet the quantitative market test to remain a public corporation. This was confirmed to us in writing in November 2019, and we were being asked to reclassify 4 months later in April 2020. The board sought assurance on the budgetary impact of not being able to retain reserves across accounting years, and we began preparing our 1920 annual accounts in the usual format. Grant Thornton paper that was sent to the board in January 2021 stated that operational freehold land, buildings and structures would need to be held at the current value, and that Scottish Canals would have to review the way we value vehicles, plant, equipment and public artworks. Scottish Canals followed up in March 2021 with a proposal on how this would be achieved. However, the structures were not part of the valuation plan at the time, and this proposal was accepted by Grant Thornton. In July 2021, Grant Thornton raised the issue of £51 million of additions, which were structures, to the canal's infrastructure since 2012. This included reservoirs and canal improvements, such as the Helix Park in Falkirk, Bowling Harbour and North Glasgow, to name a few. Previous audit reports had not raised any concerns about these projects or the fixed asset register, but a hot review in June 21, led by Grant Thornton, advising additional audit testing on capitalisations of these assets was required. At this point, we were some time into our external audit. Once Scottish Canal's completed assessment of these additions and the audit work was finalised by Grant Thornton, Scottish Canal sought specialist valuer for these additions. Grant Thornton assessed the valuer's qualifications as suitable because existing RICS qualified valuers were unable to value such varied assets. Grant Thornton approved a sample of the methodology used for the valuations, and Scottish Government confirmed that use of such a specialist was an appropriate interpretation of FREM. Valuations of 45 million of the 51 million additions were conducted, representing 88% of the valuation. However, on reflection, Grant Thornton felt unable to conclude on the judgments and estimates applied without the underlying valuation of the canal infrastructure being incorporated. This is the main tenet of Grant Thornton's concerns and has resulted in a disclaimer opinion on the annual accounts. In the evidence to the committee on the 24th of February, the Auditor General said he had not identified any core financial sustainability issues with Scottish Canals, while Audit Scotland's senior manager said it was not uncommon for ONS to recommend a change in status and not to look at the implication for the organisation. Since the disclaimer was placed in our accounts in 2020-21, we have worked collaboratively with all parties and now have a robust plan in place with an ambitious delivery date of December 2022 in order to meet the statutory reporting timetable, subject to no unforeseen issues with procurement, availability of resources or delivery. This is an ambitious plan. Grant Thornton, Transport Scotland and HM Treasury have reviewed our critical path for the action plan and have supported the approach we are planning to take. In the final external audit report to the board from Grant Thornton dated December 2021, Grant Thornton considered management's process is appropriate, key assumptions neither optimistic nor cautious, and only the valuation of specialist operational assets was raised as a significant issue, demonstrating that the other areas associated with our accounts were all appropriate. No issues in relation to fraud or irregularity were identified, and that all accounting policies had been updated in accordance with FREM. This is the exception of the valuation of specialist operational assets, which remained at historic cost in the annual reporting accounts due to the disagreement of the valuation techniques undertaken. We are bolstering our in-house expertise on FREM with external consultancy and specialist valuation report support, developing a methodology for categorising different components of canal investments, reviewing our capital policies and procedures, and undertaking a valuation of all canal infrastructure and related assets, as noted in the Auditor General's and Grant Thornton's recommendations. We will then create a prior year adjustment to restate our accounts from 1920 onwards. This is a substantial piece of work, but it will allow Scottish Canal to continue delivering significant public value for the people of Scotland in areas of tourism, net zero, placemaking and tackling health inequalities. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for that that comprehensive opening statement. I think that was useful, and we've got, I'm sure it provoked lots of questions. I'm going to turn first of all to Craig Hoy, who's got an opening question to put to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms Topley. The Auditor General's report explains that in 2012 the network was transferred to Scottish Canals as a heritage asset with no value attributed to it in the financial statements. The report goes on to state that the canal network has never been valued in its entirety or disclosed in Scottish Canal's financial statements since that transfer took place. Can you tell us why no value has ever been attributed to the canal network? Did somebody just drop the ball at the beginning of this process?
What I would say is that when the canals transferred in 2012, I'm advised, bearing in mind I wasn't there at the time, there was no requirement to do so. However, we have engaged with HMR Treasury throughout this process, who were surprised that a value hadn't been undertaken at the time. However, if I could ask SG, our finance director, to elaborate on that further, given the technical nature of the question.
Yeah, the original report by Audit Scotland, auditing our first 12-13 set of accounts, stated that we should perhaps be considering some valuation if we transferred to an NDPB. So clearly Audit Scotland didn't think at the time that it was necessary to do a valuation in 2012. There was certainly no requirement under IFRS, the International Financial Reporting Standards, and the type of accounting was more under the company's house rather than the NDPB at the time. It is only the specialised operational assets that are affected by the change in the frame. We did value all of our other assets appropriately at the time in 2012 onwards. So it's only those that have fallen into this category and are posing a problem. The original heritage asset description in 2012 isn't the same as in the frame, so it does make a difference.
This is obviously quite technical in accounting terms, so for those who watch this committee, could you perhaps say what the impact of this present situation is, both on the day-to-day operation of the organisation and also the integrity of your financial statements?
So I will address the day-to-day impact. So in terms of the elements around undertaking these valuations, I can't underestimate the volume of work that has to be done to do this. I think, you know, really simplifying the situation here, which is unfair to the technical nature that has to be undertaken, is that we don't have the canals on the books. And consequently, every time you build something or you add an asset to that, you are creating a bigger asset as you progress forward and you project forward 10, 20, 30 years. So a decision, you know, has to be made around, do you value the assets? Or as Grant Thornton, auditor, said when she gave her evidence, or do you consciously make a decision that you're going to build an asset over a period of time? And the accounts do allow for you to do that, but you have to do it consciously rather than unconsciously. So in terms of the day-to-day impact, Mr. Hoy, we are having to identify a team to be able to address this. We are having to undertake this substantial piece of work on a day-to-day basis whilst running an organisation that's gone through a substantial change to become an NDPB, whilst not an excuse dealing with the aftermath of COVID. So I really do have to say that we have an ambitious plan to try and meet the December deadline around the accounts, but that is with a fair wind and everything going well. Esther, do you want to refer to the implications in terms of the accounting on our books?
Yeah. So with regards to the accounting, I think the issue that Grant Thornton had was, although it's an asset valuation, so the assets are within our books at the moment. All these additions are in our books and records at £51 million, but they are at historic cost, not a revaluation. A revaluation amount. So we don't actually know until we do the work what the actual monetary value will be. But the issue that Grant Thornton had was it wasn't just a case of one item on a balance sheet that maybe £51 million and we change value by £10 million or whatever. It will also affect our statement of comprehensive net income and expenditure. So it related to so many different figures across the accounts. That's why they determined it was so pervasive. The determination was made quite late in the day. It was made in December because at that point we believed there would be a limitation of scope and it would be a ring-fenced issue. But having liaised with her technical team in Grant Thornton, it was clear that because of the pervasive nature and it would affect a number of figures, that they had to put a disclaimer on the accounts. Interestingly, HM Treasury does sympathise with the technicality of this. They're the ones responsible for the government financial reporting manual. So we have liaised with HM Treasury on this point. And forgive me, I'll read slightly what they've said. So they've recognised the burden on reporting entities across public sectors of this requirement. The previous technical requirement was historical cost, and now it's a revaluation requirement. So HM Treasury are actually beginning a thematic review of the valuation methodology on the government financial reporting manual that we have to adhere to for assets that are non-investment assets, which is exactly what we're talking about. It's planned to start next month, this thematic review, and it'll assess the additional effort and burden on the public bodies of requiring these complex valuations. It's also going to assess the kind of overall cost-benefit analysis of having this burden. Whilst HM Treasury is not willing to say whether this may change the accounting practice for 2022-23 disclosures, I think it might be a bit early for that to take place, any kind of recommendations. So it'll be just interesting to see what the journey is from HM Treasury's point of view.
Thank you.
Right, thank you. Catherine Topley, can I take you back to your opening statement? Because it wasn't entirely clear to me whether you accept the analysis and the recommendations that the Auditor General for Scotland has made. Do you?
We do. We recognise the recommendations that have now been placed upon Scottish Canal. And of course, we will seek to comply with this. This is why we have worked together to create an action plan that will meet the requirements of reporting in frame at the current value. I must reiterate that is not an easy task. If it were, we would have concluded it last year during the process. It is going to be complex to undertake that.
Okay, well, we'll return to some of these things. I'm going to go now to Colin Beattie, who's got some questions to put.
Thank you, Convener. ONS advised Scottish Canals in September 2019 of the intended change of status to become an NDPB. In December 2020, the external auditor shared a paper with Scottish Canals management that set out the various accounting requirements, and that was due to the change of status, of course, and where management needed to pay, it pointed out where management needed to pay particular attention in undertaking and drafting the financial statements for the year ahead. So on the back of that, I'd like to ask you one or two questions. How did Scottish Canals plan to take account of the change of status, and does it consider it successfully transitioned to becoming an NDPB?
Thank you. Once we were notified, we prepared our team to address the key changes, such as the finances and operations. In terms of the types of changes, there was significant change on how we prepare accounts in terms of the presentation of them, as well as the content contained within them. So, we had very little time to respond to that, so we sought to address that immediately. We discussed this at the board, and I will ask Mr. Thin to comment on that in a moment. And we agreed an approach that we were going to take. In addition to that, we discussed our approach with Grant Thornton, as I'd said in my opening statement, and we'd written to them and discussed an overall action plan to address some of the more substantial changes. Grant Thornton provided us with a kind of a summary of the areas that we should investigate, which is exactly what we did. I think the fundamental issue, of course, is that when we were last to look at our fixed assets and make sure they were revalued, which we did, the key issue here, of course, is the canals are not on the fixed asset register in the first place. They're on an engineering register. Notwithstanding the fact, of course, that we do have 51 million assets in this historic cost that have not been valued. And on hindsight, that was something we should have identified.
Can I ask, just on the back of what you're saying there, given the timeline, at what point did Transport Scotland as a sponsored body become involved?
Transport Scotland have worked with us collaboratively since I've come in as the Chief Executive. So we were notified in September about becoming an ONS. They were engaged in the process right through that process. We met with other colleagues in Scottish Government and they were engaged in that process, and therefore they were also engaged in the transition and understanding what the kind of consequences were of transitioning, such as, for example, not being able to hold reserves. So we had to talk about working capital, reserves, how we would change our operational delivery. We were no longer able to do multi-year projects, how we were going to do that within a 12-month window, budget planning and discussions. So They've been alongside us the whole way through this. Fran, I don't know if you want to comment on that point specifically at this point.
Yeah, I would echo those comments. Thanks very much, Catherine. We have been on a journey with Scottish Canals through their transition. We have supported them in terms of understanding what those requirements will mean, what it will mean for their expenditure, what it will mean in terms of compliance with FRAME going forward and the accounts direction that was issued in 2020. It's a good collaborative relationship, and we've also supported that with access to expertise within Transport Scotland and Scottish Government's own sponsorship departments and financial departments. So we've gone through this step by step.
Looking at everything that's been said, I asked about a successful transition to becoming an NDPB. It all seems to be financial. Is there anything that's outside financial that you had to do to comply with this?
There's a change in culture and behaviours. And what I mean by that is that as a public corporation, Scottish Canals are renowned for delivering things like the clay pits or the helix and other fabulous regenerative assets across the communities. These do not happen in one financial year, and therefore they had committed to aspects of plans and regeneration and community assets over several years. So we had to re-identify how to do these within 1 year envelopes and work closely with Scottish Government and Transport Scotland in doing that. And again, I would have to echo, since I've come into the role, our capital has increased substantially. We're now at 12.2 million and we were baselining circa 3 when I came into the role. And our revenue has also increased from about 8.5 up to 10.2. So, you know, Transport Scotland absolutely understand the challenges of running Scottish Canals. In terms of have we been successful, I think, you know, even in a financial element, Mr. Beattie, the rest of the accounts were concluded as per the transition to meet the needs. It was one area around the 51 million, and I don't want to undervalue or underestimate that area because it is an important piece of work. But I would say I think it has been, and I would ask my chair to comment on that potentially.
Can I address your question head on? Has it been a success? So clearly, if I say it's been a success, you'll say, well, it clearly hasn't been because of the why we're here. But I think we just need to be clear. There were operational consequences that had to be addressed. There were cultural, organisational, if you like, human consequences, and there were technical, financial consequences of that transition. The board was very clear that we had to get all of that right. And the board was very clear on the technical, financial thing that we had inherited a financial team that was designed to operate under the old regime. So we had to shift that. I think the transition has been successful, actually, in organisational terms, in operational terms. We've continued to deliver more and more public value from the canals. I think culturally, culture is difficult to shift, but I think culturally it has shifted. We are closer to government. We're much, I think, clearer about our relationship with Scottish Government and with the Scottish people. In technical financial terms, I think we were too slow. That's not beat about the bush. We did not have, at that time, the right skills. We needed to get those skills. We tried to recruit them. You'll have seen all the documented evidence. But it took too long to get the right skills in place. And we ended up with a technical financial issue, which is why we're here.
Specifically looking at the transition to NDPB, you worked with Transport Scotland before that, obviously. When the ONS decided that this change should take place, what steps did Transport Scotland take with yourselves in order to ensure that that went smoothly? I mean, they're the sponsor organisation, mm-hmm. Therefore I would expect them to be fully on board on this.
And they were. So when we were informed of the decision in writing in November, I was very unhappy with the timeline associated with the change and wished to pursue an extension, which is not unusual. So you can delay the implementation of that decision by a year. Transport Scotland supported me in advocating for that with ONS, and they supported me with internal discussions within the Scottish Government body core to undertake those discussions. They attended all of the meetings and they were very supportive throughout those old meetings. When it became apparent that the extension, the move to the next financial year wasn't going to be supported, they worked with us to ensure that we were ready for the delivery of our accounts.
Now we've talked to, or at least you've highlighted, changes to the financials, culture, but looking across the board, what are the key differences that change of status has made to your operation? Just give us a little bit more.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, as with all NDPBs, when you operate under FREM, there are restrictions to comply within FREM. And so that's what we do now. What that means for us, in terms of what we used to do previously, is that it is much more difficult to engage on larger projects. There are some projects that we used to engage with that would not necessarily meet the standards or the requirements of the SPFM or FREM, which make it more challenging for our Scottish Canals to be innovative, creative and deliver public value in the way that they used to. Notwithstanding that, as Andrew has stated, that doesn't mean they still do not add public value to Scotland. Since 2012, under being a public corporation, we had an economic analysis of the work that's been done, and we've created 1.53 billion worth of economic value to Scotland from regenerating the canals, and that's not to be sniffed at. I think what we want to do is make sure that there's still a way to do that in a creative way going forward, where we can maximise revenue and income to Scottish canals, lowering the burden on the grant and aid, whilst recognising the public value of the canals across Scotland.
We're indicating there's a constraint there on what you can actually achieve compared to what you could before. Is there ways around that, or have you now got some sort of a cap on your activities?
As I mentioned, if you are an NDPB, these constraints are restrictive for all NDPBs. And I think the cap is us re-identifying and re-engaging with Transport Scotland to understand what we can do now and what we can't do, and what our plans were and how we kind of move in that space. Fran, do you want to comment? Because I know this is something we've discussed as well.
Thanks very much, Catherine. Yes, thanks, Mr. Beattie. The transition to NDPB hasn't altered Minister's strategic objectives for Scottish canals. We still want to maximise the value of Scottish canals for the people of Scotland as a whole. What it has done is has introduced some practical changes to how we do that, and specifically it means that Scottish canals have lost the ability to spend their reserves without impacting on expenditure charged to the core Scottish Government budget. What that does mean is that Scottish canals have lost the flexibility to carry funds over for multi-year projects. They're moving towards a more annualised budget. And as Catherine's mentioned, that does bring different challenges. It changes how you approach multi-year projects. Those challenges are inherent to all NDPBs. They're not unique to Scottish canals. What it means from a sponsorship function is that when we look for the assurance around Scottish Canals' performance, or as we support Scottish Canals, we have changed the way in which we engage for that financial support. So there is much closer scrutiny, much closer alignment to our budget allocation processes. But again, that's not unique to this organisation. That's common to all NDPBs.
Just to be clear, it's not a question that Scottish Canals can no longer do the grander projects that it used to. They can still do that. They just have to justify it in maybe a more bureaucratic way.
More bureaucratic, but it does mean that we need to plan for that differently and treat that differently from an accounting perspective. We still have the same aspiration, we still have the same level of ambition, but we just need to manage that through the budget process in a different manner.
Are those ambitions still achievable?
They are practically more difficult to deliver, but yes, they are still capable of being achieved.
I'm not sure how to take that, but I'll accept that at face value. The one thing I would come back on is, obviously as an NDPB, you don't have the ability to carry forward year on year. And yet, I think you said that the capital had gone from 3 million when you took over to 9.3, was it you said?
12.3,
I was close. How does that happen?
Through engagement. So one of the early discussions I had with Transport Scotland was to look at the asset management strategy that we had published and to identify how we could secure appropriate funding to make sure that the maintenance and the asset was well looked after. And through those discussions with Transport Scotland, being able to evidence-base what the asset required, we were able to demonstrate the need for that funding and bid for it and secure it. And that's worked really well so far.
Okay, thanks, Colin. I know Willie Coffey has got a question in this area, so I'm going to invite Willie to put his question.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Catherine, I wonder if I could just ask a wee question on the latest change that occurred. Were you taken by surprise at the ONS's decision to change you to an NDPB? The only information we have in front of us is that The explanation was that because you carried out administrative, commercial, executive or regulatory functions, it had more of the characteristics of an NDPB. But you've been doing that for years. Well, you know, presumably. Why did the change suddenly occur, do you think? And were you taken by surprise with that? And why didn't they grant you an extension that you requested to prepare the organisation for that NDPB status?
So I can say wholeheartedly, not only was I taken by surprise, but so was our board and so was Transport Scotland. As I've mentioned in my opening statement, ONS undertook the review from our website accounts and engaged with us after they had concluded that and notified us in September that's what they had done, with a transition, you know, with a date of literally 5 months later, which is why, with Transport Scotland support, we engaged with ONS and Scottish Government Corps to say this just feels unrealistic. It's a bit of a surprise. The historic nature of it is that in 2012, so going back to what SJ had mentioned earlier, is that when they transitioned from to be British Waterways trading as Scottish Canals, there was an expectation that Scottish Canals would grow its investments, it would grow its income and its revenue returns, and it would demonstrate its ability to operate with over 50% of its income consistently being over and above that of what grant and aid provided. So essentially, you're proving that Scottish Canals is a kind of financially sustainable organisation over and above grant and aid. There were two previous assessments undertaken by ONS at the 3 year points. So what happens is ONS will give you three bites of the cherry, essentially. They'd already undertaken two previous assessments and Scottish Canals had failed those assessments to be able to demonstrate that they had met those requirements. This third assessment was, in their timeline, very visible. It was not visible on mine.
And their explanation to you about not granting the extension?
Sadly, it's very simple for them, which is we were a small organisation and we shouldn't need it. Our external auditor, Grant Thornton, actually advocated for the extension also. But of course, Scottish Canals may be small, but we are complex. We deal with third party funding. We have businesses. We have joint ventures. We have retail income. We have different contracts that are let. So it's been extremely complex. We did advocate for this with, again, I will support Transport Scotland here to say that we did this together and our voice was just not heard loud enough, potentially.
OK. Thanks for that, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Just before we leave this point, you know, Catherine Topley was asked by Colin Beattie about the support that you'd had from Transport Scotland. But I'd like to ask Hugh Gillis about the degree to which he feels any responsibility for this. I mean, if we look at the Audit Scotland report, it is fairly strong. If you look at paragraph 4, it talks about some fundamental problems about the qualifications of the person carrying out the valuation. If you look at paragraph 18, it talks about the classification of capital spend that was actually revenue spend. I mean, these sound technical, but they are fairly fundamental failings in the approach to the accounts that was made, to such an extent that Audit Scotland issued that rare thing, which is a disclaimer. I mean, we've heard from the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency recently, who had a disclaimer because they had a cyber attack and all of their data was virtually wiped out. But here you've had a disclaimer. And so I'd really like to know from Hugh Gillis, you know, how you reflect on the situation that has occurred here and what lessons you are learning as a result of this.
Okay. I will bring Fran and Leanne here, but I think from my point of view, coming into the role that I have as Accountable Officer for Transport Scotland in the middle of November last year and picking up the background to all of this, clearly this is to be regretted. I think we can say that, and there are technical accounts issues here, and I'm not an expert in that, and that's why I've asked Lee and Fran to support me, because they have the background to this as well. So this is to be regretted. Lessons do need to be learned out of this, and we will endeavour to learn those lessons along with Scottish Canals, and we'll reflect on this as well in terms of other NDPB chief execs, and there's a forum for them, and we'll reflect on those learnings. In terms of what I've seen in my role, is, and to reflect what Catherine has seen, is that we, Transport Scotland and Scottish Canals, in their journey to change of status, have tried to work collaboratively together. And when issues have been raised in terms of technical accountancy issues raised in terms of towards the back end of the year by Scottish Canals to us, and even prior to that, going back to September 19, and some of the issues we've heard around the financial capability that Andrew's described, we've tried to go towards that and recognise that. But you know, obviously, the fact that we're having to sit here today is to be regretted, and we need to learn lessons out of that. I would absolutely say that to the committee. But I don't know if Fran or Lee would like to add anything to that.
Thanks very much, Hugh. So the questions are, what are our reflections on Transport Scotland's role? And I would like to answer that first in the generality of around how we obtain assurance for the activities of Scottish Canals in our capacity as sponsor, and then answer on the specifics of this example. So plainly the two organisations have distinct accountable officer accountabilities, and there are legitimate professional judgments that are exercised by the executive team at Scottish Canals. It's not our function to superimpose our judgment on those legitimate judgments that are made, but we do obtain assurance on those through a number of means. First, we know that the executive team has access to appropriate professional support and advice. We supplement that with access to professional support and advice from within Transport Scotland and broader Scottish Government finance teams. There is a robust internal audit and ARC function within Scottish Canals, and of course the board itself brings extensive scrutiny to bear. So all of that provides us with a reasonable degree of assurance in terms of how Scottish Canals do manage its finances and do manage their business. On the specific question that we are facing today and that led to the Section 22 report, I mean, it's a fairly narrow point, and not to diminish the significance of it, but it is a narrow point around the valuation of assets, where I think it is regrettable that we collectively didn't pick up on that, but I think that wasn't done through any negligence or a failure to address the question. It was that a judgment was made informed by professional advice, which turns out to have been the wrong judgment, albeit it was reasonably made and reasonably supportive, and we accept that, and we accept the auditor's recommendations in the report to move that forward. So I think here what we have done to obtain assurance around the approach to date and going forward is to work very closely with Scottish Canals. The issue was identified relatively late in the year, even in discussions through October and November, where we were working closely with Scottish Canals and Grant Thornton. The nature of the issue hadn't yet quite crystallised, but we will work closely with Scottish Canals to move that forward. We are aware of the critical path on the action plan that they've identified. We take assurance from that. And as Hugh has mentioned, we are thinking about what that means more broadly for other NDPBs, both within Transport Scotland's portfolio or more broadly across Scottish Canals. Scottish Government.
Thanks. I think that's helpful because, I mean, I don't read this report as being simply a narrow technical issue that's led to a snag. I mean, for example, one of the critiques in the report is that the people that were appointed to carry out the asset valuation didn't appear to be qualified to carry out the asset valuation. I mean, how on earth could that happen?
I think that's an interesting statement. So in terms of the valuations, and I will ask SJ and Lee to comment on this, we did work with Grant Thornton to identify the scope of the valuation that was required. We agreed the scope, we agreed the methodology, and we also agreed the individual who was going to undertake the valuation. It wasn't until after the valuation was concluded that Grant Thornton reviewed it and came to the conclusion that they felt it wasn't sufficient. So I will ask SJ to expand on that further, and I know Lee will also have a comment around this, around the timing, because that ultimately has led us to this position.
So to be clear, for valuing investment properties, we use the appropriate RICS qualifications, valuers. This is a very different set of assets that we're talking about. So just to run through the example of the 51 million, which I think brings it a little bit more to life. £25 million worth of the additions were in 2013-14, so they have been on our books and records for quite a long time. Some have been reservoir improvements, some have been sea lock and gates associated with the Helix Park. Around £17 million was associated with the Helix Park. £2 million were on Pinkston Paddle Sports in Glasgow, and up to about £6 million were in the Bowling Harbour regeneration. Ardrishaig Pier of £1.6 million and the North Glasgow clay pits as well is around £6 million. So these were not assets that a RICS qualified specialist felt comfortable valuing. They are very wide ranging, which I think comes to the core of the issue. The issue is that although these assets were absolutely on our fixed asset register appropriately, they were capitalised on a project basis. You know, they're big figures, so they weren't componentised as another accounting term, but they weren't split into what elements of land, what elements of engineering construction, what elements of, you know, all the various elements that go into landscaping, embankment improvements, weirs, all of that. So thereby we couldn't use a RICS valuer. We did ask Transport Scotland and Scottish Government colleagues and HM Treasury whether an alternative type of valuer was needed, and it was determined a specialist engineer should be doing these valuations. Now, clearly, Grant Thornton are now saying actually some of the land assets could be done by RICS, and some of the elements of them could be done by a RICS qualified person instead. So that's part of the journey that we're planning on, to really break down these assets into components. So it is a really technical issue. Break down these assets so that we can actually determine the valuers and use appropriate valuers, a range of valuers in the future.
I don't want to put the blame on Fran Pachitti's shoulders at all, but I observe that your job title is Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals, which is a flavour of the scope that Transport Scotland is involved in. And presumably in those sectors, there are engineering-related assets as well as land and natural assets. So didn't you have expertise that you could bring to bear to give advice to Scottish Canals in carrying this work out?
Yes, and we did. So we have experience in valuing assets, not just through our non-departmental public bodies, but also through, for example, the Trunk Road Network, and of course through other NDPBs within our portfolio, which include Highland and Island Airports Limited, CMAL, where we do have experience in valuing assets. So we did bring that to bear. We did bring that common approach to bear. But there were the assets in the Scottish Canals portfolio are unique in nature. So despite that engagement, that attempt to seek common ground on how we should do this, and despite best efforts to achieve that, the valuations that were undertaken didn't find favour with the auditors at the end of the day.
Okay, I'm going to move things on and invite Sharon Dowie to ask some questions. Sharon.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. The Auditor General's report outlines that the auditor issued a disclaimer in the audit opinion of Scottish Canal's financial statements for 2020-21 because insufficient audit evidence was available to conclude on the overall valuation of Scottish Canal infrastructure and inland waterways. This is largely because Scottish Canals did not obtain an appropriate valuation using depreciated replacement cost DRC for around £51 million of specialist operational assets which had been capitalised between 2012 and 2021. You've kind of touched on some of those. So could you tell us why Scottish Canals did not identify the need to undertake a DRC valuation of its specialist operational assets as part of preparing its 2020-21 accounts?
Thank you. So I think two parts to that. As I will draw you back to my opening statement, we had prepared and written to Grant Thornton in March and advised them of the approach that we were going to take. That did not include the assessment of those assets, and at that point we had not received feedback to say otherwise. Notwithstanding that, hindsight is a wonderful thing, and we should have. In terms of the DRC, we did undertake the valuation, and that's the discussion that's just been held there. The issue is that when we did undertake the valuation, after some period of time where Grant Thornton were crystallising the issue with Scottish Canals, the valuations that were returned by the specialist engineer, Grant Thornton concluded it wasn't sufficient for what they needed. At that point in time, we were in November, and we were very close to coming to the statutory deadline for reporting. And therefore, we were very limited in our ability to be able to challenge the auditor's opinion on that and be able to work with them to identify how best to move that into a space of delivery beyond it. Can I ask Lee, I know you were involved in the trunk roads valuations and you provided specialist advice around the valuations for Scottish Canals. Do you want to comment on that?
Certainly, yes, Catherine. I think the complexity of the exercise in undertaking such a valuation is really what's at the nub of all of this. And I think SJ mentioned it when she was talking about the components that make up the canal network. And I think there was a figure earlier quoted of some 4,000 odd assets. And these are really the critical thing about is the information that's required in order to generate a valuation. It doesn't necessarily require an RICS qualified valuer to do all of it. Some of it, yes, it may be appropriate, but this is a very complex and unmarketable asset. So you need the information and you need to be able to apply a process to that information in order to generate quite a complex valuation. And that's essentially what we do for the trunk road network. It's not undertaken specifically by an RICS valuer, it's undertaken by a technical company which does the valuation incidentally for all of the road authorities within the United Kingdom. So that gives you an indication really, I think, of just how complex this will be. And I think Catherine has recognised the challenge of the December deadline, and I would certainly support that as well.
Thank you. It does actually sound very complicated and complex. So could you tell us a bit about the progress in updating the fixed asset register so that all assets will be appropriately recorded and categorised?
SJ, do you want to comment on the fixed asset register?
Yes, it is going to be complicated. I'm not going to underestimate it. And although we have quite clearly said that our aim is for the December 2022 deadline, because that's our statutory deadline for our annual report and accounts, it will be challenging. So at every part of the action plan, we have a detailed action plan that has been agreed by Transport Scotland and Scottish Government colleagues. It has the support of HM Treasury, who will advise us on our methodologies on the way. And it has also been agreed with Grant Thornton, which is more important. We are actually changing auditors during the course of the year. So our new auditor, just to add, you know, some fun. Our new auditors, the Audit Scotland deem, or the Audit Scotland appoint, they'll be involved in the process as well. We just don't know quite who they are as yet. So we will be engaging with consultancy, which we'll have to go through a procurement process, so that will take time. At the moment, we're doing some pre-market engagement with some key accounts firms who have huge amount of knowledge in the NDPB area, public sector in general, but particularly with regards to the government financial reporting manual, which is the key issue. We're working closely with them to understand the specification of what we can then go out to market with. Also, we'll have to appoint an array of valuers as well. But the first few months will literally be having a look at all the methodologies of all the different component parts of our assets. Now, as Catherine mentioned, it's not that we don't have the canal infrastructure noted anywhere. We have a very complex engineering system, an engineering asset management system that does detail our canal infrastructure in its entirety. It's just not tied up to any financial asset register. So we do have a note of it. So I don't want anybody thinking we don't know what our assets are. We absolutely know what our assets are. It's just that they haven't been appropriately valued under the frame. So working with the engineers, working with a consultancy firm, we'll be looking at componentising all of these assets with regards to a financial valuation and relative to what Grant Thornton are expecting. We will be supported in our judgments and estimates. So I'm hoping there'll be a path. The critical path is really to get Grant Thornton to agree our methodologies as we develop them and agree our capital policies as we develop them, so that by kind of September, October time, we're in a position to actually finalise all these valuations and they can complete their audit. We're actually running two different programmes. So we're getting a project manager in who has NDPP experience and huge experience in FREM accounting, whereas our internal team will be concentrating on actually producing the annual report and accounts as well. I know it's just one adjustment. It will be slightly more complicated than one adjustment. But yeah, I just wanted to reassure the committee that we do have a fixed asset register. So we're not starting from scratch in any way, shape or form. But there's quite a journey.
So the completion date will be December 22 and you look as if you're on target?
So far we're on target, but yes, it's an ambitious target for December. What we'll be doing on a monthly basis is not just us, but Grant Thornton also will be committing to reporting to board on the progress, and any issues that arise will be flagged very, very fast.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Sharon. I mean, and so you said earlier on that you did accept the recommendations and analysis that's contained in the Auditor General's report, and that does include, doesn't it, on paragraph 5, an undertaking that a new valuation process of the canal infrastructure estate in its entirety will be completed during 2022. So you are committed to that, presumably. And the audit report goes on to explain why that's important. This is not just about a technical exercise and ticking a box to comply with ONS requirements or HM Treasury requirements or Scottish Government requirements. This is all about medium-term financial planning and strategy for Scottish canals. So, I mean, it is an important and quite central part of how are you going to look to the future, what your plans are going to be. I mean, again, you accept that deadline. What happens if you don't meet that deadline?
So I would have to be honest, as the accountable officer sitting here today, I have my concerns that we will be unable to meet the deadline. There is a recognition that the market forces are really challenging at the moment, that the availability of staff and specialists is really challenging at the moment. And we need these individuals to be able to support us to deliver this project and to meet this deadline. Notwithstanding that, the complexity of agreeing the methodology, then the evidence to support the delivery of the valuations has to meet the standards that the auditor has set out. We don't know what the standards are yet. And the issue we're dealing with is that we're dealing with retrospectively creating a value for something, some of which is 250 years old, some of which is 10 and 20 years old, all of which were put in our books in a very different way in which the auditor is asking us to present them now. So in very simple terms, we don't have the evidence in the way that the auditor might like it to be presented in a nice tidy binder that would allow us to do that. So we have to create it. We have to create that evidence trail with the methodology, with the valuations, with the auditor. And we tried to do that, of course, between July and August last year when we did the valuations. And when the auditor looked at them, she felt that wasn't sufficient. So my concern is more fundamental around resources, timing, and making sure that the valuations can be done at an appropriate standard that the auditor can sign them off. And at this point in time, it's not just the 51 million that we're talking about anymore. What the auditor was able to crystallise and articulate in December, which ultimately led to the disclaimer, was that fundamentally these assets, it's not just the 51 million we've been asked to look at, it's the canal infrastructure. So the canal, we've been asked to look at if the canal should be on Scottish Canals books. And if they are, you're talking circa 2.5 billion that you're adding to Scottish Government's accounts. Now, Lee went through the process of identifying how to put the roads on Scottish Government's books. And as he's already mentioned, there is a comparator. There is the UK roads. There is another comparator around there around how the books are on another government set of accounts. We do not have one for canals. England's canals are held as a charity, so they do not sit on Scottish Government or on government books. So I don't want to labour the point. We have been very ambitious because we have a statutory reporting deadline. We will aim with everything that we have to meet that deadline. And I am confident that my team understand now the need. It's whether about all those other moving parts come into play at the right time. And those will be the challenges for us that we have to manage.
OK, thanks. I'm now going to ask Willie Coffey to come in with a number of questions. So, Willie, over to you.
Thanks again, Convener, and hello everyone once more. Catherine, I wonder if I could start. I'm looking at financial sustainability and going forward, but did you say in your opening remarks that the Auditor General said he had no core financial sustainability issues with Scottish Canals? Did I pick you up correctly there? Did you say that at the outset of the meeting?
And I will quote from the minutes, said Auditor General said he had not identified any core financial sustainability issues with Scottish Canals, while Audit Scotland senior manager said it was not uncommon for ONS to recommend a change in status and not look the implications for the organisation. That's a quote from the meeting on the 24th of February.
Right, thanks for that, Catherine. But I couldn't see that in the Audit Scotland report that we've got in front of us, but what I could see is a comment on the financial statements from 2020-21 that show your income at 18.8 million and your expenditure at 22.7 million, and that's a deficit of 3.9 million. So I'm wondering how we can square that comment with that set of facts in the financial statements. And we also know that we think there's a maintenance backlog of £70 million there. So how do we square those comments about financial sustainability and no concerns with the figures that I've just read out?
So I think the first thing I would say as accountable officer, and I'm sure Andrew would agree with me as the chairman, is that we would not say there are no concerns. We are a public sector organisation, and therefore we have the same challenges and burdens placed upon us as the other public sectors. And so with that in mind, we work to balance the books. The last 2-3 years obviously have been impacted by COVID. We have not been able to trade. That has substantially affected our income. And so as a consequence of that, we have had those deficits, and we have recognised them in our accounts. If I take you to the years before, you will see that it was break even in terms of the accounts. And we have been working with Transport Scotland for them to understand the revenue challenges in Scottish Canals. Our biggest cost in Scottish Canals, of course, is staffing. And beyond that, in terms of medium and long term financial sustainability, we are looking at how do we adapt the operating model to be more efficient, including things like ensuring that the efficiencies come from operating models that are user dependent through to systems that can take away the need for a more manual interventions. So we are very aware of the opportunities that are presented there to us. In addition, in terms of income, we do have opportunities to trade. And as we were talking about earlier, in terms of being an NDPB versus a public corporation, we need to work through those. The aspirations from ministers haven't disappeared. They still want us to be innovative and creative. They still want us to generate our own income. And so what we have to balance constantly is the challenge and pressures of today's financial burden versus taking the burden off the revenue requirements in the future years by investing wisely today. And we continue to do that. In terms of the maintenance backlog, Mr. Coffey, something that we absolutely recognise in Scottish Canals. And I have to say, even if Scottish Government said to me today, here's £70 million, go and fix it, I couldn't do that in one financial year, sadly. I don't have the technical expertise and resources to do it. The asset manager sets out the strategy and the blueprint that we've taken, which essentially works on safety, risk and economic impact. And again, very similar to other public bodies, Historic Environment Scotland, for example, you will not always have the money to bring these to the standard of today overnight. What you have to do is have an asset management register that identifies where the higher risks are, where you need to deploy those funds more immediately, and what the longer term implications are of not spending money. And that's where that backlog comes from.
Has that figure of £70 million been factored into your financial planning going ahead, or has the £70 million been agreed with anyone? Where's the money coming from to carry out that maintenance backlog?
So it's not, we've not agreed £70 million will come to Scottish Canals from Transport Scotland. What we have done is agreed the asset management strategy with them in 2019. And what we then did, as you'd seen, as you refer, if you'll remember earlier, is our capital went from £3 million to 12.2 million, which is absolutely wonderful. It allows us to start addressing this backlog at pace. What I must do, though, is remind the committee is that the canal is 250 years old. So as quickly as we are remedying and fixing and replacing assets on the canal, you have degradation on other elements of the canal. So because you can't be on, you know, the 140 odd miles at the same time at any given time. But what we mustn't do is think of the canals as a burden. We all know what they looked like 20 years ago with the brown water, with the shopping trolleys, with the cars, with the couches. More importantly, you know, infestation, you know, issues around public health. And now what we have is a beautiful canal that contributes to the economic growth. You know, as a result of the regeneration of canals, we've generated and been able to offer, you know, 8,000 homes across the canal network, not personally, but it's because of the regeneration of the canals. The builders have come in and said, yes, it's a wonderful place to live, to build. That then has little ecosystems, as you know. Tourism is massive in Scotland, and we've really benefited from that during COVID, and we hope to leverage off that going forward. I think just coming back to the last point about the medium financial planning, SG&I have commissioned an organisation to undertake that work for us. We've looked at our previous investments to see which ones have been more successful, and we are looking to present to Transport Scotland in the coming months a business case that would represent the kind of activities we would want to be engaged in, why we should be engaged in them, and how they benefit Scotland as a whole, as well as the economic benefit for Scottish canals.
Right. I mean, you're bound to need some kind of allocation to assist you with the maintenance backlog. I mean, we can't wait year on year on year for that. There has to be, surely, some kind of annual recognition of that and some kind of allocation of funding to support that good work that you've described there, Catherine. So it's not clear to me that money's coming, or because you've said you need it for the work that you intend to do. It's not clear to me at all that money is going to be forthcoming in the next years, the next year and the year after.
I'll ask Fran to comment. It's our sponsor.
Thanks very much, Catherine. Mr. Coffey, again, this issue is not unique to Scottish canals, and it brings us back to the discussion that we had at the outset of this session, where the change to NDPB status means that we are working within annualised budget cycles. So there is, in the 70 million, there is both an affordability and a capacity challenge in doing that. So we have to look right across the portfolio of assets that we own and prioritise where we invest in that maintenance backlog on a risk-based approach. I think we are successful in doing that. But we also have a capability and a capacity challenge. So what Scottish Canals maintenance plan does is programme that investment over a number of years based on priority, based on ability to programme those works in a sustained fashion. As sponsor body, we sit hand in glove with Scottish Canals and going through those budget processes so that we have a common understanding of what's available, what are the priority allocations and how we spend that going forward. So there is a backlog. We are managing that backlog. It is not without risk, but we are aware of those risks. And again, those challenges are not common to Scottish Canals. I think it's replicated across a number of assets in the transport portfolio and across a number of NDPBs.
Mm-hmm. Would we as a committee be able to see some future point if there has been any allocation towards that maintenance backlog, so that we can see as a committee that progress has been made on it? It's great to be able to talk in terms like this at the committee, but real changes on the ground or at the canals would be appreciated, I think, by the committee, so that we could see that moving forward. And lastly, convener, Catherine, you talked about, you know, because of this status change, it gives other opportunities to generate income. Could we also see some signs of that as you move forward as a committee, that those kinds of changes have been embraced by Scottish Canals, and how that might impact in your future financial statements?
Yes, Mr. Coffey, we'd be happy to share that. I would reiterate, because I think it's very important, when we published the asset management strategy, there was a £70 million backlog, and I can demonstrate the funding that has been provided between then and now as to what that has done to the 70 million. That does not mean that that 70 million is the figure today, because as I reiterate, you've got the what you've addressed historically versus what is coming up and what you now know about. So that figure will always move, but from the baseline, we have been able to track our investment from Transport Scotland and the additional budget. In terms of the additional opportunities, absolutely, we'd be happy to share that with the committee.
OK, many thanks for that. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. Well, I think that draws to an end the questions that we've got this morning for you, and we'll obviously reflect on the evidence that you've been able to give us, and you know, we may pursue some lines of inquiry with you after the meeting. But can I thank you very much for coming along and being present in the committee room. It's good to have people sat in front of us so we can properly inquire into what your response is to what is a very serious report which Audit Scotland published. So can I thank Catherine Topley for leading on the evidence this morning. It's appreciated. Andrew Thin, thank you very much. Sarah Jane Hanna, thanks to you and the team from Transport Scotland, Hugh Gillis, Fran Pacitti and Lee Shedden, thanks very much for giving evidence too. I'm now going to close the public session of the committee and go into private session. Thank you.